Good afternoon. Now, having listened to a broad overview of the different systems which we can have in the hospital, we'll now look into the more critical area of the operating room. As we understand, it's important to have standardized systems in the operating theater, and this would range from the pre-op patient preparation, intra-op surgery, post-op care, and sterilization. So in the course of the next few slides, I would discuss the different practices which we follow here for these aspects. Now the preoperative record is as here. The preoperative record, basically we try to capture whether the patient is monocular, the different ocular aspects and the systemic aspects. So ocular, we look at the kind of cataract and the presence of any coexisting comorbidity. The idea is, you know, we also have this transferred onto the database, and these patients we would get would be operated on by a senior surgeon. The patient counseling is again a very, very important step. So once the patient is seen by the doctor, he goes to the counselor, and the counselor would talk upon the different surgical options, whether it's phaco or SICS or ECC, and the different lenses as well. The doctor would only advise a specific procedure. In case, for example, the hypermature cataract, he would probably advise SICS. Otherwise, it's the counselor's job to advise for the different specific procedure and for the lens. The counselor would also speak upon the different options of the different rooms, daycare or admission options. Another important job description for the counselor is kind of having it as a checkpoint for the preoperative workup. For these counselors would ensure that everything required for surgery is done. This would include the blood pressure, tension, duct, IOL power calculation, etc. And they would also talk about the prognosis aspect. So most of them, as we know, are going to be having a good prognosis, but if they have a guarded prognosis, or if required for near vision for monofocal lenses, or the need for PCO, all of this is touched upon by the counselor. Regarding the supplies required for surgery, we have a specific sub store within the theater, and all the supplies for the lenses, viscoelastic, etc., would be available there. We have had issues in the past that we didn't have all the lenses available. For example, if you're having an aspheric lens, 21 diopter required for that day, we might have three patients. We might just have three lenses in the store. Now, because the counselor enters the IOL power in the software, we now have a list of what lenses are required for the following day. So we have a real-time entry. So this is one such report, but we have a real-time idea of the specific lens for different powers, number of lenses which we will require. So it's easy to plan the store. So this is true for the different aspects like viscoelastic. Most of them is HPMC, but some of them we might need a viscote, or we might need a high visco, high molecular weight viscoelastic, etc. So any of these deviations are planned prior itself, so that on the day of surgery there is no requirement to spend additional energy or to postpone the patient surgery based on these requirements. Regarding the posting of surgeons, as you know, in Aravind we don't have a unit kind of a system, so we plan the different surgeons on a monthly basis. And beginning of the week, we have a list of the different surgeons who will be operating. So this list, for example, in the paying theater, we have the different theaters listed, and we have a list of who would be operating on which day of the week. By planning ahead of time, we know if someone is going to take leave or they're away on a camp, we can always exchange. So that planning is done well ahead, if not the previous day, maximum, in case it's the doctor is not well, etc. Again, the idea is we want to maximize the surgeon's time, so we do not want to plan, have it in the last day, we would have a table free, we might have extra patients. So the planning is done based on, number one, the number of patients which we predict for surgery, which is done on a yearly or monthly calendar, and the surgeons are also planned ahead of time. And then we allot the required staff for each area, like surgery, anesthesia, or sterilization. And we highlight the difficult cases on the case sheet. So here, this is how the folder looks. It's a yellow color folder for the cataract. And we highlight what specific procedure the patient will undergo if it's a monocular patient. This one basically highlights what kind of cataract it is. So we have the cataracts grouped into three areas. So by one, we say the straightforward, immature, large pupil cataracts. By two, we would say the posterior polar, high myopes, the hard cataracts, mature, intumescent cataracts. And a grade three would be a subluxation, a secondary IOL iris fixation, etc. So by grouping these patients into different groups, it becomes easy, one, for the nurses to plan distribute the cases for the surgeons, because in our system the nurses would ensure that the surgeons have the different patients on the table. Only about 10% of our patients would opt for a specific surgeon. So 90% of the patients are, you know, they're done by any surgeon, unless of course it's a difficult case. So if you have some complex situation, a surgeon who is probably senior enough or trained to do that case would be handling that case. Otherwise, it could be done by any other surgeon. So one thing which we use is trying to grade them, whether it's simple, complex or complicated, to ensure the patient's outcome is not compromised. And again, it's important to ensure the equipment is up and running. I think we've probably it's been spoken about in the past. It's not enough to just have all the equipment there, the machines, the microscopes, but frequent cleaning, monitoring every Saturday, you know, by ensuring everything is done, we kind of try to reduce the downtime. And the theater is very important. Like if we have one instrument maintenance person, technician in the theater all through the day when the OT is running, because you do not want to have a FACO machine not running even for a few minutes. It's just a wastage of time. So that is the kind of effort which is taken to ensure the equipment is all running and is in place. The different duties, as we know, range from anesthesia, preparation of cases, draping, surgery, end of surgery activities, and record writing. And the doctor mainly, as you see, the energy is in the surgical aspect. We have a different surgeon, most probably a resident or a junior consultant, who would be in charge of anesthesia. Otherwise, the surgery part is all the surgeon would have to look at. All the rest is taken care of by the circulating nurse in the theater, the scrub nurse, or the nurse in the block room who takes care of the pre-op preparation and workup. The stages of work could be broadly classified into the activities in the preparation room, the anesthesia room, the activities in the OR, and the sterilization of instruments. You've probably seen the theater during your tour. I'll just quickly go through the different activities which happen here with the help of a video. So this is the block room, and the block room is manned by two senior ophthalmic nurses, a few trainee nurses, and about three postgraduates. We do not have an anesthetist here in the block room all the time, but if it is a complex case or a patient with sedation, the anesthetist would take care of those patients for the adult cases. So the trainees, they would be in charge of applying the cap and the shoes. They also would be responsible for checking the blood pressure. And we now have an electronic blood pressure monitor that makes it, you know, more reliable instead of having them check the BP each time. So they would also cross-check to see if the identification matches the patient and with the case sheet. So this BP is checked for all patients irrespective of whether they're hypertensive or not. ECG is done for patients who are above 40 years of age. So this is the checklist which we administer prior to giving anesthesia. This checklist again talks about the right procedure, right eye, right technique. It also talks about whether the A-scan has been done, whether the patient has used topical antibiotics pre-op. So this patient has opted for the topical anesthesia surgery. So the paracaine drops are applied, and then we use the iodine to clean the eye. Once in the block room, again once more on the table before the surgery starts. The anesthesia, if it is the decision of whether it is a topical or retrobulbar, again in our system rests with the nurses, unless the patient or the surgeon specifically mentions it before that. About 70% of the FACOs are done by topical. So other 30% would be done either because the surgeon is not comfortable or the cataract is a little bit more advanced. So this is the wristband which you saw, and this is like we have it for all the inpatients. And this is again to cross-check the identification aspects. In the theater, we have the two-table system. So each surgeon works on two surgical tables with two scrub nurses. Again, before the surgery, the patient is prepared. We have a timeout to check the patient identification details. And as the surgery is being done, the adjacent patient is being prepared. The idea is we do not want the surgeon to be waiting between cases for want of the patient to be prepared. So as this case is done, the patient moves on to the next surgery. Just use alcohol scrub between cases, and maybe we'll change the gloves every 10 cases or so. So in between cases, the instruments are taken for, they're cleaned and then they're packed in bins, and we use a high-speed autoclave to autoclave them, and then they are brought back to the different theaters. So as we have seen in by Dr. Ravindran's slides, the resources which we need probably is one extra scrub nurse and having a few more instrument sets and having two operating tables. So by that, we can actually increase the surgeon's productivity. So SICS probably they would do around 8 to 10 to 12 cases per hour on average, probably about 45 to 60 surgeries at the end of a 6-hour session. FECO would be about 5 to 6 cases on an average, and it would probably be around 30 to 35 cases after 6 hours. So this again, it is not just having the surgeon trained, but mention that the whole network is working. The main challenges that you see in having to do high volume is, number one, to have competent surgeons. And competence is, again, more to do with training. It's also to do with volume. So we find that after a point in time, most surgeons are able to perform high-quality surgery. So I think just by doing more, they do definitely get better. And also, it's the allocation of cases depending upon the mature or the advanced lenses, and ensuring a constant flow of patients. So we don't want either to have, we don't want too many patients to be waiting and the surgeons, are slow. We don't want that to happen. Or we don't want the surgeons to be doing it very fast and there are no patients prepared in the block room. So it's very important to be able to match these two activities. So the nurse in the block room has to be aligned to what is happening, and kind of there should be connection as to the number of patients being blocked or prepared, so that there is no waiting either way, and ensuring good supply of surgical sets. So having spoken about the operating room, I would just move on to the next part of my presentation, which is going to look more on monitoring of patients who undergo cataract surgery. Monitoring, as we know, it's very helpful to kind of raise the outcome from the actual level to the desired level. And once we know the actual level, then it is, we understand as to what kind of stones we have to have in place to get the desired level of care. So in terms of monitoring, I would start off with complications monitoring. In terms of complications, I probably have seen the case sheets during your rounds yesterday. So we have a format where it's all full of check boxes. So most of the intra-op notes, the surgeon details, it's all in the form of check boxes so that can be transferred onto the database, onto a software. So this entry into the case sheet is done by the circulating nurse. Into the software is done by a MRD nurse. If it's a complication, the notes are written by the surgeon. Otherwise, it's done by the nurses. And once this data is entered into the software, we have a report. And this report is shared with the surgeons on a weekly basis. The report is also shared with a much larger team. That is, almost all of the operating room nurses and a few doctors would review this data in the form of a formal meeting held every Thursday afternoon. The reason why we don't have the doctors come to the meeting is because, one, it is a lot of time. It's about 90 minutes of their time every week. And number two, it's also a little sensitive to have them sitting in the room and having their complication discussed openly amongst the whole team. So, but all the same, we want the doctors to be aware of what is happening. So they sign off the sheet before the meeting regarding the complication which has occurred, how it has been managed, the outcome, etc. And once it has been discussed, based on the data and any other aspects which have been discussed, we have the minutes and probably have any changes in the protocols, which is shared by the doctors and the nurses to the rest of the team. And then we probably review it after a few weeks to see if that has been followed and has got the required effect. So this is the software which we have. The software has the patient demographics, and we have a drop-down menu for the complications, which step the complication. For example, if it is a FACOM ECC procedure, we have a specific list of the steps involved. So that comes down. The action details, again, the post-operative complications, if any, how it was managed, any reoperations, late post-op complications, etc. Now, the idea of having this is, number one, it's difficult to track each of these patients when we're doing high volume. So all the 91,000 surgeries done in Madurai, data is entered into the software right from the pre-op data, the intra-op, day 1, day 30, any late post-op. So all of this for each patient is captured. So we'll be able to track the outcomes for these patients. It also helps us to understand if you want to know how a specific surgeon is performing or in terms of what visual outcome which he is delivering with his surgical, with his surgery, if you want to study up any of this, this is useful for us. Or to study the number of complications in a period or like one specific complication, how many have we had or with one technique. Any of this is possible by having to do this. It is a little, kind of cumbersome in the beginning. I mean, the software part of it is certainly the easy part, but the challenge is trying to have their team to enter all this data and to use it effectively. The data entry is done by a non-clinical person, but it's reviewed by the clinical team on a weekly basis. So this team, this is the report which would come from that software, and we look at the basically the volume of surgeries done and the paying, free, and CAM. This is data from the from last week. And everything from anesthesia complications, post-op complications, reoperation, it's all seen. So this is the intraoperative complication rate, the paying, free, and the CAM. And it's we also kind of do a more detailed post-mortem. So in each of these patients, we look at the pre-op, the intra-op, and the post-op data. The idea is we just want to look for patterns as to why this complication could have occurred. Is it to do with a specific surgeon, a group of surgeons, or a specific technique, or a kind of cataract? We also want to look at how these patients were managed. It's also important to see if the protocols have been adhered to as the patient got a good outcome following the complication. So this is true with the post-op aspects. So all of this is being measured with this in this weekly meeting. So this weekly meeting is not just look just at data, we also look at any other flaws which we might have in the previous week. If it to do with anything to do with manpower, to do with the flow of patients, to do with any equipment, all of this is also discussed along with this. And it's useful because everyone who's involved is there in one team and one area, and it's you're in a mind frame where you're not actually on the job. So we don't want, it's okay to have once in a way to have patients waiting too few, but we don't want this to become a habit. So once we have such situations, we use this forum or try to address it as early as possible so that that will not be a recurring event. It's more of a crisis once in a way. The overall complication rate, obviously, what really matters is to have each complication, each surgeon look at his own complication. To do that, each surgeon will have an idea of the number of surgeries which he has done. So the surgeon, for example, looking at surgeon G, total number of surgeries is captured, the number of complications he's had, the intra-op complication rate, the post-op complication rate, rate of reoperations, and any infections, if any. So it kind of gives a comprehensive report for each surgeon as to how they are performing in terms of volume, the quantity, as well as the quality of care. And it's also easy for them to benchmark if they want to with their colleagues. For example, amongst the residents, amongst the fellows, etc., they also are in a position to benchmark. This is not put up in any notice board, etc., but we have this subtly sent through emails, or we might have it available, so they always can come and, pardon? You had some questions, sir? Okay. So if you have any, they could also kind of look at it if they want to improve their own targets. Again, the training part is again important. So even if someone has been trained, they might need to go back to training if you find the complication is very high. They might be exposed to more surgeries, might be asked to attend the grand rounds, discussions, video sessions, etc. In terms of training, for the trainees, we normally use the Oscar scoring sheet. Now this is actually recommended by the ICO, and here each of the techniques, ECC, FACO, or SICS, we have a grading for all the 20 steps. And for each of these steps, there is a score from 2 to 5. And it gives you exactly the steps which you'll have to take to improve from a novice surgeon to a competent surgeon. So for example, if you want to look at capsulotomy, you would know exactly the what you would have to improve upon to be a competent surgeon. So based on this, the trainer would score the trainee for each of the steps for each of the first 20 or 30 surgeries. And that would be kind of, instead of just looking at has this doctor had a complication or no, yes or no, or was he independent enough? So this is a more objective score. It's not so much based on the trainer, but it's a more objective way of knowing the progress of the training. And the report also is shared with them. So this is how the report would look, and we have a graph to know how he has performed over those 20-30 cases. So having spoken about the surgical care, I mean, a lot of it is provider. We take responsibility. We ensure that we do good surgery. We ensure that we place the right lens. It's also important for the patient to feel that he is an important part of the care. It's our responsibility to make the patient understand that he plays an integral role in having the right outcome. So some of the areas where it is important where he is compliant, there would be probably be the follow-up, probably be using the medications properly so that he does not have any need, inflammations are not occurring and there's no need for reoperations, etc. And he also uses glasses if required. So in terms of these issues, we did have a problem with follow-up and patients having a mix-up with medications, and as is true with many institutions, and that is constantly a challenge for us. So in our system, we have the counselors talk to the patients regarding the need for follow-up, and we give them a date, and we also talk to them about medications. But also, just to be doubly sure, we also have a checklist now which we've developed to be sure that this information has been shared to the patient regarding medications, how to open the bottle, how many times to apply, the main points. So the use of checklists basically is in areas where we find that, number one, it's very critical for us. For example, in surgery identification of patient, or in areas where we find it is very important that somewhere we have a very weak area and we want to improve there. That's again a point where we would consider having a checklist so that everything which we want to be looked into is done. So this definitely has helped us. Like we have something called as on date follow-up. That is, the patient comes to the hospital on the appointment has been given. And that is probably was about 55% for us. Now it's up to 65% by ensuring the patient has his say in the date for follow-up. Because the patient knows that this hospital is open 6 days a week and he can come in any day he wants. So the mindset is they can always walk in any time between 2 to 6 weeks. So, but to make the patient adhere to appointment is important. So small things like this definitely do help us. Other than looking at the worm's eye view, it's also important to have a bird's eye view in terms of monitoring. In terms of the complications, this is just one report we have for different groups of surgeons. So this is for like the IOL fellows, the number of surgeries they have performed, and the complications and reoperations. So this kind of reporting system makes, you know, whoever's overseeing the training understand, and the surgeons themselves understand how they are performing. And they also helps them get a target as to how they can improve. We also have something called as the cataract core group meeting, and this is we look at everything which is important in terms of cataract care in that meeting. Again, this data is not so much to look at why, it's more a sheet where we start the discussions. We discuss more about interdepartmental issues in that meeting. So everyone from the counselors to the OP nurses to the MRT staff to the refractionists to theater staff, ward staff, we all just get together to look at how we can smoothen out the differences within different departments, and everything right from surgery acceptance rate, advised versus acceptance, daycare, complications, infections, post-op complications is looked at, visual outcome. For example, if you see the visual outcome, this is for the month of this March 2012. And this is for March 2011. So most of the comparison is done either amongst our 6 hospitals or it is done with our same patient volume in the previous year, the previous month. And the unaided visual outcome of 660 or better, this should be 618, yeah, was little lower than the free hospital. And we found that this was probably because of the staff we had, the refractionist there, was not being good. So once we had a more senior staff, I think then we found that it was a little better. So our target is about, without changing anything with the technique or the incision site, just by looking at, re-looking at the way vision or refraction was tested, we could know that the visual, there is a flaw here. So this, we know the same group of surgeons operate both the free and the camp patient. So there should not be so much of a difference between the free and the camp. So this has definitely improved in the current year. So finally, I think as mentioned by Dr. David Chang, I think quality is accomplished in part as we can make a science out of streamlining cataract surgery and achieving best possible results while minimizing costs, and cost-saving measures should not be compromising care. Thank you.